So we're going to start the event with a newsreel of 1985. But also, we have there's two halves. I'm going to be hosting the first half. And then there's somebody who's going to, Rennie's going to be hosting the second half of the period. And in this half here, we have Brother Devon Thomas, Brother Howard, Stafford Scott, and Lee will be giving you a little breakdown of how it felt for him back in those days. So we have Brother Devon, which is from Hover, North London, which, you know, as you know, there was an uprising in North London around about a week later because of the killing of Cynthia Jarrett. So, you know, it's all tied in, and it's a unified approach that we're taking towards getting justice for the family of Cherry Groce. Are you with me? Yeah. I can't hear you because I'm feeling like the vibes is a bit kind of sad, you know. No, the vibes knife, man. Are you with me? Have we been here so long as black people that we get so reserved? Oh, yes. Let off, relax, but the spirit go. Cherry's in the house. We want Cherry spirit from moving, and Cherry wasn't a look of dead stocks, Maddy. Live. So one more time, I'll go give it to for our English people. One more time, I'm going to give it to you. Yeah? Are you with me? That's better. Without further ado, I'll turn you over to my brother here, and we're going to switch the lights, and we're going to show a newsreel. Okay.
Fires are still burning in Brixton in South London after an evening of rioting. It began as a demonstration of anger after police had shot and seriously wounded a woman while searching her house. Then a crowd attacked the police station and gangs of youths began burning and looting buildings. 31 policemen and 5 civilians have been hurt. Mike Mackay has been at Brixton all evening.
This was the corner of Brixton Road and Loughborough Road, 5 hours after trouble began outside the local police station. Petrol bombs rained down as riot squad police held the line behind their shields. Similar scenes were occurring all round Brixton as the disturbances spread in all directions from the Brixton police station. Fire and ambulance services trying to enter the area found many streets blocked off. At the corner of Cold Harbour Lane, a 4-storey building collapsed after being set alight by petrol bombs. The top 3 stories were flats over a furniture shop, but they were thought to be unoccupied. By this time, hundreds of firemen and scores of fire engines were dealing with burning buildings, mostly leaving blazing cars simply to burn themselves out. Throughout the night, dozens of cars were taken from their owners and turned into blazing barricades. Hundreds of shops within half a mile of Brixton Police Station were looted and wrecked.
Mike Mackay reporting. That's all from the newsroom for now.
Yes, thank you, brothers and sisters, for being so patient with that moment. And it's a moment that resonated in my mind dearly because one of my children is born. In fact, my firstborn is born on the same day as the day it happened. And at that time, you know, she would have been about 2. So while one's supposed to be celebrating the birth of your child, it was a mixed emotions, you know what I mean? And me did out there. I fling and I go on and I do certain things. I mean, I say everything when I do, but me did out there. You know, the midst of the goodness of retaliation. And that's how we retaliated. But the way that they gave the impression that they would give, that, you know, we were looting. You always remember, looting. They always put that in there because they have to do that because Middle England would react to that. Robbery, burning down people's buildings and things like that. Remember, you know, 4 years before that, we had an uprising for something that was similar before. And there was another couple after that. There was one in 93 when them kill my youth there. Two of them them killing them, I have the same name, but the Muslim family. Douglas, yes. Yeah, so you know, it's not the first time, and it hasn't been the last time, that the police have been so heavy-handed towards people in our community. But what we're going to do now is that Howard is going to come and tell us what happened on the streets. Howard, where are you there? Howard. Well, Howard ain't here at the moment, so we'll just move on from her. Because Howard is a brother that who's intricate in Brixton at the time. An elder, and he's a barber. So what we'll do, we'll get Devon Thomas to come. Okay. We'll get the father of Brixton. Went to Tulsil School. Tulsil School don't exist no more. Then build flats upon it because people like him too bad. But in bad pun the poetry, please give a big round of applause for Linton Kwesi Johnson. Yell him!
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. I was just thinking that it was clear to the black youth of my generation when we were growing up that the police had declared war against us. And indeed, they have been waging a protracted war of attrition against young black people, because we, the youth of my generation and every other subsequent generation, have refused to tolerate certain things that our parents reluctantly tolerated. And in remembering Cherry Groce today, I think we should spare a thought for the loved ones of those who have died in police custody over the years and continue to die at the hands of the police. Well, I'm just going to recite a few poems to get things going. I'm going to do a poem called The Great Insurrection, which was about the first riots we had in Brixton in 1981. And if people will remember, some of you are too young to remember, but in that year, we had the new, what we call the New Cross Massacre, when 13 young black children, teenagers, died in a fire that was the result of an arson attack on a West Indian party. Those kind of attacks were commonplace back in those days. In that year also, the New Cross Massacre Action Committee mobilized some 15,000 to 20,000 people. And we marched from New Cross to Hyde Park to protest the death of those young people and the way the matter had been handled by the authorities. It was a march for justice, the Black People's Day of Action. That was on the 2nd of March, 1981. And it made the British state take note of the fact that we had some power and we were prepared to use that power. And of course, in April of that year, 1981, we had the riot down here in Brixton, which I recorded in this poem called The Great Insurrection. It was in April 1981, down in the ghetto of Brixton, that the Babylon them caused such a friction that it bring about a great insurrection. And it spread all over the nation. It was truly an historical occasion. It was event of the year, and I wish I had been there when we run riot all over Brixton, when we mash up plenty police van, when we mash up the Wicked One plan, when we mash up the Swamp 81. Fiwa, to make the rule of them understand that we not take no more of them oppression. And when we check out the ghetto grapevine, to find out all I could have find, every rebel just a revel in them story. Them a talk about the power and the glory. Them a talk about the burning and the looting. Them a talk about the smashing and the grabbing. Them a tell me about the vanquish and the victory. Them said the Babylon them went too far. So what we had was for bond to care. And one and two innocent get mar. But what? Now so it go sometime in a war in star. Now so it go sometime in a war. Them say we burn down the judge, we could have burned the landlord. We burn down the judge, we never burn the landlord. When we run riot all over Brixton, when we mash up plenty police van, when we mash up the Wicked One plan, when we mash up the Swamp 81. Them say we commandeer car and we gather ammunition. We build we barricade and the wicked catch afraid. We send out, we scout, figure find them we're about. Then we farm up, we posse and we make we raid. Well, now them run gang go plan counter action. But the plastic bullet and the water cannon will bring a blam, blam. Will bring a blam, blam. Never mind scar, man. Will bring a blam, blam. I'm just going to do two more poems. This year marks the 15th anniversary of the death of the late Bernie Grant, Member of Parliament for Tottenham. And back in 87, when we had the first batch of black people elected to the House of Commons, amongst the four people, Bernie Grant stood out because he was the one, the only one, who had real community support, grassroots support. So when he passed away, I wrote this poem in memoriam for him. Some of you will remember how they tried to demonize Bernie Grant when they had the riots over in Tottenham, because Bernie Grant had said, "The youths told me," that is Bernie Grant talking, "the youths told me that the police got a bloody good hiding." And that comment was attributed to Bernie Grant himself. So they tried to demonize Bernie Grant. And anyway, this is the poem. "Like a skilled tradesman, you paved the way. From the shop floor to the council chamber, all the way up to Parliament front door, and then you enter as a member. And we remember the eruption over Tottenham, Mrs. Jarrett heart attack, down at Brixton, Detective Lovelock shot Cherry Groce in her back. The rage and the storm, the death of PC Blakelock, Broadwater Farm. You was with Chief, you was with Chice, you was with Champion. You was with Fierce, you was with Vice, you was with me and man. And we remember how the press and the rest try to lynch you. How them try to tar and feather you. How the Haring gave a massive rally round you. How you make black people feel proud of you. And we remember how you build the unity in your community. Dedicate yourself to your constituency. Brace your broad back against bigotry. And stand firm for justice and equality. You was with Chief, you was with Chice, you was with Champion. You was with Fierce, you was with Vice, you was with me and man. Them said that if you're going into politics, you have to well tough and can take no flicks. You was with Ali in I'm prime. You jab them with your left, you hook them with your right, and you take truth force and beat them every time. Now it sound like louder bells are tolled with teal, but a few precedent are go prevail. Them no know how the parson get him gone, but all know me still a hear for your sound. You was with Chief, you was with Chice, you was with Champion. You was with Fierce, you was with Vice, you was with number one." Finally, a poem which, let me just call this poem a contribution to the campaign against black deaths in police custody. It's called "License for Kill." That kind of conversation between two people. "Sometimes I think my co-worker crazy, the way Christine would have gone jokey jokey. Then the next time now, a no nonsense stance. The way she wind down the place last Christmas dance. The way she love to talk about conspiracy. Me and Christine in the canteen a talk about the death of black people in a custody. How not a cat make meow or a damn dog bark? How nobody are you up in a society can offer explanation nor remedy? When Christine it up her brow like see a row, she a go row. Screw up her face like see a trace, she a go trace. Here or now. You think I just MI5 and James Bond and police and soldier over North Island one? When it come to black people, Winston, some police in England got license for kill. Well, nothing Christine say surprised me still. But hear me now. What you mean, Christine? Who tell you that? I must be one idiot. You can't prove that. Who tell me if you go say that? Christine kiss her teeth, then she cut me with her eye and she say, you want proof? You can't ask Clinton McCurbin about him asphyxiation. And you can't ask Joy Garden about her suffocation. You can't ask Colin Roach if him really shoot himself. And you can't ask Vincent Graham if him stab himself. But you can ask the commissioner about the license for kill. Ask Sir Paul Condon about the license for kill. You can't ask the Douglas them about the new style baton. And you can't ask Tony Hassan about him death by neglect. You can't ask Marlon Downs if him have any regret. And you can't ask El Gamal about the mystery of him death. But you can ask Dame Barbara about the license for kill. Ask the DPP about the license for kill. You can't ask Ibrahim about the CS gas attack. You can't ask Mrs. Jarrett how she get her heart attack. You can't ask Oliver Price about the grip round him neck. And you can't ask Steve Boyce about him dead by neglect. But you can ask the PCA about the license for kill. Ask the ACPO about the license for kill. If you ask Maggie Thatcher about the license for kill. And you can ask John Major about the license for kill. If you ask Michael Howard about the license for kill. And you can ask Jack Straw about the rule of law. If you ask Tony Blair if him is aware or care about the license for kill that plenty police feel them got. Sometimes I think my co-worker crazy. The way Christine would have gone jokey jokey. Then the next time now, I know nonsense dance. The way she wind down the place last Christmas dance. The way she love to talk about conspiracy.
Give him another round of applause. And we've never stopped doing poetry like that over the years. And the elder is a vanguard in that. Well, we've got a younger version coming up later on. I just want to call up Stafford, Devon Thomas to come and take a seat here, please. Lee, can you come and take a seat, please? They're going to be speaking and things like that. So Devon is going to do his thing now. Yeah, he's going to do a PowerPoint presentation, and Devon is a old Brixtonian. So this is the real Brixton, not what you see today. Yeah, this is the real Brixton. These are the people them who were part of making Brixton what it was, and what it's turned out to be even today. So give a big round of applause for Devon Thomas, please.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. Good evening, brothers and sisters. Yes, so we have vigor. We didn't get here by being weak-hearted and weak-voiced. I came to this community in June 1956. I said, Arnold, take a deep breath. He couldn't come here, he hadn't been born yet. But yes, I was 6 years old. I arrived here with my mother. And we lived first down in Vauxhall, and then after the usual machinations, partner paying and so on, we moved to Ratchel Road in 1959. And even up to that point, we had to struggle hard because life was very tough in the United Kingdom in those days. You didn't have central heating, fitted carpets, and all those things. When I come here and frost and snow bite me, I'd never seen or felt cold, never see snow. Get bronchitis every winter. But you had to be resilient and you had to adapt. And with my brethren, Linton, we all went to Tulsin School. It was a rough old place. When you was in the first year and reached that school, there they had a 9-foot terrace wall. And the big boy, them used to throw the first year over the wall. That was our initiation. And if you never stand up, and if you never thump down two boys, you didn't survive very long there. Even though many of us did have two brain and did want to achieve, but you had to survive street style as well. Anything you wanted, you had to create it. There was no state provision, youth club, all those things we had to create it with self. We start with like a youth club around Allardyce Hall, 1964. Start football team in there, cricket team, table tennis team. Linton came, had the desire to write, and I'm starting poetry club inside that youth club back in those days. Anything you wanted, you had to create it. Our parents came with that tradition. My parents then come through the Garvey movement back home, come through trade union movement back home, then bring those same sensibility here with them and started things here. For jollification, starting at time, then we'd hold a little party in the house. The mother would cook curry goat and rice, oxtail and various things, sell it to the 2 and 6 a plate, long life beer. And my uncle had a silica sound system and he'd bring pan the boat with him. And we used to make a life in London. And as the second generation come, we start to do what we could do. Start to organize. We start a little thing in our youth club. We thought we was being smart. When the police did start harassing, we set up a thing called the Help and Arrest Scheme, which was a card that go with the youth club membership. And it had what was called a judge's rules. In those days, they didn't have all these modern legislation supposed to control police behavior. But there was some guidance. And it was told you what they were supposed to do when them approach you. And we think, say, well, the police did take notice of the rules. So we put it upon this card and every club member have one. And it was red. But it was like a red rag to a bull. Because every time a policeman see a youth with one of them, him lock you up because him was incensed, the idea that you could hold him to any kind of account. And when you get locked up in those days, him no fine you for several days. So we was up against it from the early days. But we was a collective set of people in those days. We used to move together. We organized youth club together. We used to go dance together. We used to defend each other. It was a time of solidarity. Now our first big challenge as a generation was in 1973. You know that the fair come to Brockwell Park every year. And all of them empty out the gas meter and go up there and pay for go up and ride and all kind of thing and jollify yourself. But that particular year some disagreement happened and some boy buck up with this African man and him get licked with a glass. And police come a long time after the thing done. And three young men were up there that were at school with. And the police drapes them up. Robin Sterling, Harris Parkinson, and another young man. And railroad them into jail. They wasn't even there when the incident happened. But in those days, they used to concoct up evidence and say, it's you. And as a community, we weren't as progressive as we should have been. We had some local lawyers took on the case, didn't prepare it good, and the boy them get convicted for something they don't do. And the Brockwell 3 was one of the first community action in terms of defending the interests of some young man. We take up the case, and even our younger brethren, who was organizing a thing called the Brixton and Croydon Collective, spearhead the campaign. And after a year, we get appeal, and then we get exonerated on appeal. The only problem was them they had jail for a year already. One of them get mashed up bad. They never even really recover. Because at that age, 15 and 16, when you go get sent to jail, another kind of very impressionable stage. It affects you for the rest of your life. So, that's the kind of basis we started from. And at that time, them start attack with. Them say we are mugger. Them start the moral panic around black people and street crime. So, we were up against it. We had many radical movements. It was based here. The Black Panthers, the movement was based on Shakespeare Road, number 38. You had other groups organized, and even our youth club used to feel it was radicals. Call myself the minister of that, the secretary for this, and the minister of defense. Linton, all right, we say we black petty bourgeois army full of flour. But it was all good stuff because we were learning about ourselves. And we organized and we took all of our youth club members back home to Jamaica that same year and get to understand where we did come from all those years before. The gentrification business, we come and gentrify it. But them decide there was a slum and them try to compulsory purchase the whole of Brixton and it was going to lick it down. This was how Brixton was supposed to look. No. Everything that was there, the Astoria, which became the academy, the fridge, everything was going to level. And it was going to be these 55-story block of apartment buildings that we're supposed to live in. It was supposed to be a roundup, a flyover, and a motorway run through the middle of town, and an underpass commander it, and all kind of spaghetti junction. This was the planner's vision for Brixton back in those days. And we get a letter through my letterbox, a Ratchet Road, said, I'm going to go buy it, take away the house, not buy it, take it away and give it £50. That was the nature of how things work in those days. You couldn't appeal or anything. Them just tell you, say, I'm come for your house, give £50 and you go about your business. After my people, them come here, work hard, save them money, throw them partner, buy them house, make some life, bring them kids up like me, bring some more children, have some children here, and I try to make a future. Every time we make some progress, them try to cut me off and send me back. But we fight it, and we beat it. We beat the plan. They had to throw it out. When the Jews and the Arabs went to war in the Middle East, the economy dropped through the floor when the petrol price go up. I remember when young used to get light 3 days a week. You have to buy a candle. You couldn't buy a candle for you had man sit down out up a Brixton by the bus stop and sell candle for y'all pound a piece. Because you couldn't buy them. And Mr. Heath said, I'm going to the country to see who rules England. And then find out, say, I know him. And dash him out. And we get a little ease up for a few years. I'd gone to college. Both me and Linton go to Goldsmiths College. It was the nearest sensible college to here, you see, down on New Cross there. And come back. I'm start running a little youth project in the middle of town here called the Central Lambert Project. Homelessness was rife. Everywhere, brick up. So we start with some of my schoolmates, them, Harley Carty, and a few others. And we start fix up the house, them, and give young people somewhere to live. And gradually we start rebuild the place. This is Stockwell Park Estate. We did campaign to stop them building it. Because when we're looking at the plans, there's all 3- and 4-bedroom plot. And there's no provision in there for play, anything. There was 160-by-90 football pitch. And that was the only thing that was there for cater for young people. Through CLP, we get them for turn some of the garage them in a youth club. And we create a community center down the bottom. And at least them had somewhere where they could start organize themselves. And also, in the middle of the 70s, a new organization came into Brixton. It was called the Race Today. Them find a little office that was part of BIFA, one of the organizations I was involved with, and them set up them office there and moved from King's Cross and became an influence in Brixton. Start to write, used to help them distribute the magazine them around colleges and things like that. And everybody who was radical have an office on Railton Road. Everybody, even people you wouldn't necessarily dignify. But anybody that look freedom or protection, and come there, nobody no trouble them. All right? And so our community has begun to develop this reputation for radicalness, for rebellion. But right up to the early 80s, nothing wasn't going on economically. Our kids were coming out of school with no jobs. The education getting send more than that. Many of you, I'm sure, never even realized that we had a windmill up on the top of Brixton Hill. You know? We have a prison and a windmill. That's the breadth of the experience in Brixton. Electric Avenue, the first street with electric light in the country. The Band Marsh was the first department store in the country. In the country, the whole country before Harrods and Selfridges, we have a department store here. Because this was a very affluent community back in the 19th century. And we come and we bring ourselves to it. And then when the youth them couldn't find an outlet, and Linton explained, after them burn up the youth them down in New Cross, after Bristol have a little skirmish down in the Black and White Cafe in St. Paul's. And we did have some things before that, 1976, at the carnival in Notting Hill. That was a little skirmish. Right, 77 down in Lewisham, the fight, the National Front, and then you had Southall, them kill Blair Peach. So things was going on the whole time, but finally, people say it get too much. Them start a thing in 81 called the Swamp, where them say black youth was draping up people and thieving them things at the bus stop, and having all kind of things. So them bring in a squad. And I remember in during that run-up time, my mother was an ageable lady, and she got on a Brixton with her shopping bag, and police stopped her and searched her shopping bag one Saturday, the week before the flames went up. So we know something was going on that was even out of what we were used to. And a young man, I'm in an altercation upon Railton Road, him get stabbed. Some of these people stop him, drive him into the cab, and I question him while him a bleed. And the man them who hung out on the line didn't like it. And say, take him to hospital. And they told them to go. So them open the police car and take out the boy outside, put him in a cab and send him go to King's College Hospital. So them bring SPG. Anybody know what the SPG is? Special Patrol Group. They call them tactical something or other squad now. But these were the boys who, when things were serious, they were in these big white vans. And they brought them in. And I was supposed to go to cricket. We'd start the cricket team, come out to the youth club years before. And the boy them come to collect me for go practice tonight. And when Nick on the door, I'm open the door, the boy said, come, something not going out to Railton Road. So me lock my door and we run around there with a brother named Eric Knight and a couple of boys. And we go around there and we see 6 men pick up this mini and carry it in on the road and just turn it over like it was a bale of straw. And as the petrol start pour out, backlanting everywhere. It was like a war zone because them licked down Mail Road and Railton Road at the time. And holy pa corrugated iron was around the place. And you just go behind it, pile of bricks, buckle. It's like them designed it specially for urban insurrection. So the police never know what they might do. And the boys run line man them decides to cho. Nah, take it again. And as them SPG van come up the road, the boy them jump out from behind the thing and brought it the van. And we were seeing the van skew to the side of the road and the man them jump out, look around and run where left it. And I thought, hang on a minute. Don't you see them kind of thing you know, going around here? And I see a big phalanx of man come down the road and them have crates and thing and them, you know, there was a spirit, it's like Haitian Revolution. Everybody reached the same frame of mind at the same time. So we all know what did happen. You saw those footage. And through the 80s, that was characteristic. It wasn't just happening in 81. After them announced the report, they had a police meeting at the town hall. It buckles again. And then finally, 85, they decided they were coming for the mothers. And, you know, they came down to Cherry's house. She was there with Lee and the rest of the children. Michael, who they said they were looking for, never lived the house, and it wasn't there. Kick off the door, 2 o'clock in the morning, and shot her. And the bullet lodged in her spine. She never walked again. I was called at my house. I was chairman of the defense committee all through the 80s. We'd formed it in 81. And we kept on a ready footing any time. I got a call from my colleague who worked at Law Center. And we go around there and we set up operation that same night. And I lived in the Law Center for the next week. And there's a brethren here, I won't name him, me and about another six guys, we live, sleep on the floor in there and command the phones. Not like today when you have mobile phone and thing. If you wanted to sort out things, you had to be there night and day. I just send my family go live a country. Because I knew, I could see every time I walk the street, man, I follow me, them turn out my dustbin, tap my phone, all them things. I've lived with that for the years. So this is the what challenge you take on. Over the next few years, we had to work with the family and they've not seen justice. And I've tried to do what I can with the knowledge and experience I've built up. I've also tried to mobilize the community to create something that is dignified and worth us staying here and living. I've remained here. I'm had four children and seven grandchildren. My granddaughter managed to graduate from university last year with a first class honors degree in maths and computer science. Born and grew up Brixton. This dysfunctionality them talk about, I don't know where they are. All of us boys who come here in the 60s were brought by parents. We try and keep in touch with one another. We reunion every now and again. And this is one of the biggest reunions. 30 years after the act, we're still here. All this talk about gentrification or whatever, we're still there and we're still important and still running things. I'm part of an initiative where we're going to rebuild Summer Linton Road and we're going to name Summer Linton after Cherry. Because those pioneers who came in the 40s, they settled there and we have to make sure we remember them and do things in the spirit that they would like. Lee, the rest of the family, we're behind you. We're going to make sure, say, this don't stand. Because if it stand, none of the other injustice can deal with. Thank you.
I think we need to give him a bigger round of applause than that. Boy, I don't know about the rest of you, but I got goose pimples running down my back and my arm and everything like that. You know, Devon, you know, we give thanks for men like you. You are a true African warrior. You know, and you know that you're behind the family. Now, you're not just behind the family. You're at the side. You're in the front. And some things that you did, and people don't really, a lot of people now see how the police behave now. And there's a lot of legislations that's been put in place. A lot of those legislations that's put in place to deal with them now was because of men like this. And because we decided that, boy, I knew something was going to happen in Brixton that day, 1981. Because you could feel it in the air. They were walking around in half a dozen. They were pushing old women over. No uniform. It was bad the day. I never forget it. I remember that day like it was yesterday. A lot of people who are not African Caribbean in those days could not see or feel what we were going through. It was very, very serious. And it was the height of their sus law. So the police just didn't need no records. Them just need to just feel you're going to thief something. And they can take you to court and they can find you guilty for it. Because it happened to me and happened to many of my friends. And it happened to a few of our, you know, it happened so many times to other people that they said, cha, I might as well do something. Because that's what it was. And it was mainly young people that they did that. So when they would stop us, you'd find men like him. There's Brother Minka in the place here today. And Brother Earl, the man who was a load of you, them and them thing there. Because more time, you know, man never afraid of police back them time there. Never wasn't scared of police. We stood up to them. Anyway, we don't want to go on too much. We have a brother. And this is just to show you that this is in South London, Southwest 9 and Southwest 2. This was happening. But to show you that it was going on all over London, We got our brother from North London, Brother Stafford. Please give him a round of applause. Stafford Scott. He's going to come and tell us what happened in Tottenham at the time.
Respect, respect. Big respect to Brixton. Yeah, as the brother said, my name's Stafford Scott. I hail from a place called Tottenham. Come from and used to work on an area called Broadwater Farm. The times that we hear Brother Talk Devon talking about, we kind of lived through those times with Brixton. Brixton was the spiritual home for black people, for African Caribbean people in those days. We looked to Brixton for a bit of culture, good food, all kinds of cooked food, and a bit of leadership, because here is where people were in numbers. Brixton gave leadership from even before those days, from the days of the Notting Hill riots, when man was getting mash up and bash up and rock up in Notting Hill. It's well known, it's well legend, that is when the people from Brixton left Brixton and went down there to help them, that that battle got dealt with. So yeah, Brixton has a history. So when we in Tottenham hear about a black sister, a black mother being shot in her back, as she's turned and running away, running upstairs, we felt it in Tottenham. We may not have kicked off in the way they kicked off here, but believe me, we felt it, we talked about it. Everybody in our community knew about it, and we was enraged. So when exactly 1 week later, a brethren of mine, a brother called Floyd Jarrett, is arrested in Tottenham. His crime was for driving a BMW car whilst being black. He stopped. They say the car's stolen. The car turns out not to be stolen. They say that they opened the bonnet. They say that the number on the engine does not match the number on the manifold. The engine manifold does not match the number on the tax disc. So they arrested him for having a dodgy tax disc. Remember, they stopped him for stealing his own car, and it turns out to be his car. In them days, they'd give you a producer. But as we've heard today, and as we've been told, in those days, policing was different. The reason we didn't fear policing is because we had no choice. The police presented themselves and told us that they were another gang. Too often, we've been arrested, we've been in vans, and before they beat us, they'd show us their National Front badges. Too often, we'd fight against the National Front on the streets, telling them I'm not ready yet, ma'am. Too often they find the national, we'll be fighting the National Front on the street. And as we give them some licks and turn around, they'll be coming back at us, reinforced by their mates in the police force. So we had no choice but to stand up to the kind of policing that we received. So my brother Floyd gets arrested for having an out-of-date tax disc. They take him to the station, and there's one of those local hero bobbies. Back in those days, we used to have a program, Sweeney. And you'd always have that bad man cop, that one cop who was going to be the Avenger, who was going to clean up all the bad men. Problem is when they show it on the program, the bad man cop always picks on bad men. So when he does bad things, we tolerate it. In this scenario, the bad man cop just decided that he was going to clean up all the black youths that lived in our community. He was off duty. He was on his way home, and he saw these officers bringing Floyd Jarrett into the station. He decided he was going to put in some voluntary work. Now let me tell you, policing hasn't changed that much. We've said it's changed, but it hasn't changed that much that police officers do voluntary work. He decides that he wants to stay, and he decides that he knows that Floyd Jarrett is, in police parlance, a scroat. He's one of them boys from Broadwater Farm. I've told them I'm going to have them. So now we have a reason to go and a justification to go to his house. But he didn't have no reason or justification, because reason and justification equals a warrant. He didn't have a warrant. He stole the keys of Floyd Jarrett from out of his property, got three other officers, and went to the Jarrett home. Floyd told them where he lived. He didn't live at his mummy's house. He lived away from home. But he didn't have an away from home key, so they took the key that allowed them to go into his mum's house at Thorpe Road. They didn't knock on the door, they entered using the keys. His mum and his sister and a grandchild was in the home when they came in. Can you imagine? Especially as a woman, with no men in the house, opening a door and just seeing four alien men hanging about in your living room. And when you ask them why they're there, they tell you that they're there to carry out a search. And what they did was, because she wouldn't move out of their way, they pushed her out of the way, pushed her over, stepped over her, carried out the search, and left. It was a rapid search, a really quick search. You know why? But they knew they weren't going to find nothing there. They didn't find nothing there. When they left, Randall radioed back to the station and said, the search is over, it went A-OK. Unfortunately, the woman that he had pushed to the floor, didn't attend to, didn't pay no mind to, stepped over, she was having a heart attack. He didn't even call for an ambulance. He radioed his station and said that the raid had gone A-OK. And then he left. And Mrs. Jarrett was having a heart attack. And she died. So imagine us in Tottenham 1 week after they've shot a black woman in a nightie running upstairs. And now you come into Tottenham and you go into a home with no lawful reason. And you cause that death. We call that murder. We don't care what your jurisdiction calls it. If I, as a burglar, came into your mum's house and pushed her over and killed her, you'd know it was murder. So we got vexed. And what did we demand? We demanded that the police officer who did it was suspended. We went to the station to demand he was suspended. And what we got was fobbed off, told that they didn't have the power to do that. And then he turned up at the window smiling at us. So of course, some of the youths then got a bit and started to fling some stones at the window. And I took a decision to take them away, to take them to the farm, to go back to the centre, to regroup, to work out what we should do next. And that's what we did. And when we was leaving Broadwater Farm, when we was leaving the farm, the police surrounded the farm. One of the things they said, so the farm is built on stilts, so they came in underneath the stilts. Bam, bam, bam on their shields. Bam, bam, bam. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Monkey noises. You lot staying here. And one of the things they kept on saying is, this ain't Brixton. Because some of them had obviously been there the week before. Some of them felt that Brixton was a warm-up and now they was going to be able to carry out acts against us that they couldn't do up here the week before. Stay in there. We'll let you out when we want you out. But they underestimated the anger in our community. They underestimated the power and the rage that that anger can create. It's not about a one-off incident. I've heard people talk about SOS. First thing I was ever arrested for in my life was SOS. First criminal record I got was SOS. And I swear, it was a crime that didn't happen. It's not that some other black kids did it and we got arrested for it. It was a fabrication. And they used that against us, thousands of us. And the difference between SOS and stop and search, SOS was an indictable offense where they didn't need no witnesses. They'll take it to court and tell them in court, we saw him trying to dip that woman, but they didn't have to present the woman. Let me tell you how powerful SOS laws was and how they used it against the black community. When we finally got them to abolish SOS, they had to close down detention centers. Detention centers was where they sent us, short, sharp shock, they called it. They'd brutalize us on the street, frame us up, and send us in those institutions for them to brutalize us. But what they didn't realize is they were toughening us up and getting us ready for nights like October the 6th in Tottenham. So on October the 6th in Tottenham, we call it an uprising. We do not call it a riot. We never loot no shop. We didn't mash up our community. Anything that got mashed was mashed to use to fling against the police. One supermarket, we went in and we took what we needed to take. And what we needed to take was cans and bottles that we could fling at the police. It wasn't looting for looting's sake. It was focused. And it was so focused, in a period of 3.5 hours, 243 police officers were injured. 3 police officers were shot. 1 police officer, as we all know, died. They make a big deal about this officer that died. last year they had a man on trial for that police officer that died. They put a police officer on trial for the shooting of Cherry Groce. His name was Lovelock, Inspector Lovelock. He got off and then they promoted him. And in Tottenham, an officer called Blakelock, he didn't get off. He got murdered in a horrible way. And today, well, in 3 days' time, is the anniversary of that event. I get called on the radio by radio stations and TV stations asking me what we're going to do on Broadwater Farm to celebrate, to remember, to record the 30th anniversary. And I've not responded to none of them because I don't want to tell them the answer. But this is the answer. This is what we say in Tottenham. This is what the older generation of farm men say. Blakelock's dead stock. That's done. We don't talk about riot no more. We won. Not only did 243 officers get injured that day, not only did one get killed, but we had the police come back and run a vendetta campaign on our community. They locked us down. Never seen anything like it. They locked us down for 18 months. There were some days when there was 9,000 police officers standing up on a 1 square mile estate. 9,000 police officers. They took away our friends. They framed people. Mark there? Mark there? Yeah? One of the men they framed is even in the house today. They framed people. Locked them up for a murder that they didn't commit. They demonized my brethren Winston Silcott's name. Can't tell you what they did to him. You'd have to have lived through the time to believe the things that these people could say, do, and get away with. We went into a court 6 years later. There's lots of what they call case celebs at the time. Birmingham 6, Guildford 4, all these cases. Irish people who had been demonized as terrorists, proving that the police were corrupt and bent and framed them up. It took them 10 and 14 years to get out. It took us 6 years to prove that the Tottenham Three were innocent. When we proved that the Tottenham Three was innocent, the most significant thing that happened was able to prove that they framed Winston Silcott, that they inserted pages into the statement of his so-called confession that wasn't true. They inserted those pages. They got him sent to prison. In the court of the O'Bailey at the time, the officers who run that investigation stood there. Detective Chief Superintendent Melvin, Detective Chief Inspector Dingle, and they said, we broke Winston Silcott. 6 years later, we proved that their statements were a fabrication. Those two officers were arrested and charged with perjury and an attempt to pervert the course of justice. It's really irrefutable, isn't it? There's three people in a cell or an interview room. One of them gets framed. The other two come out with the statement. These people manage to go to the Old Bailey and somehow they get off. They walk. I'll tell you how they do it. They don't call the third person who's in the cell to give evidence. That's the state. So let's be clear. Our war wasn't just against the police. It's against the CPS, the DPP, whatever they call themselves. Our war has always been against the state and the system. So the Tottenham Three get off. Now these guys got to get found guilty, haven't they? Because this is the biggest case in the land. It was the most intensive and expensive murder investigation ever carried out. And the men who were convicted get off. The guy who prosecuted them, Roy Amlott, sharpest QC in the land, when he finds out what they did to Silcott, he says to the appeal court judges, my lords, had I known what they did to Silcott, I wouldn't have prosecuted none of those Broadwater Farm cases. And guess what? This Don QC that we hated with a passion because he was sharp and good at his job has never prosecuted again. Became a human rights lawyer because of what the police involved him in. And then they went back to the Old Bailey with their shenanigans and somehow these officers managed to get off. So at that point, this is what we say on Broadwater Farm. Justice? Justice ain't white. Justice is colorless. If we can't get justice, you can't get justice. So we say today, on the 30th anniversary of the uprisings in Tottenham, it's the last that we're going to talk about it. We'll talk about Cynthia Jarrett, because everyone needs to remember Cynthia Jarrett, but But we're not talking about Blakelock no more. There's got to be some undercover in this room, because there's always undercover. So make sure that when you go back to Scotland Yard, you're telling them, Stafford Scott said, Broadwater Farm said, Blakelock is dead stock. The last trial that you took over Nicky Jacobs last year, the disgrace of a trial where you had three witnesses, three people have been paid, three people who are seeking a reward from the News of the World, three drug addicts, three alcoholics who previously had given evidence and testimony against Winston Silcott, suddenly switched their testimony to make it be against Nicky Jacobs just so they could get a result. Courtney Griffiths is in the house somewhere. Courtney defended Nicky. And I've said this before, and I know he knows I mean no disrespect. I could have defended Nicky. A blind person could have defended Nicky. It was the worst possible case you could have ever imagined. Three key witnesses saying that the murder happened in three different locations. Three key witnesses who put different weapons in the man's hands at different times. Absolutely scraping the barrel. So desperate are they to prove their superiority and their supremacy. Well, Broadwater Farm says you weren't superior on the night. We beat you on the ground, we beat you in the courts, and now we're telling you it's over, it's done, and you know that. And I'm going to chill because I've got to come back and talk in a second part, and then I'm going to go into a little bit more detail about what happened on Broadwater Farm that night. Thank you, people.
You know, oftentimes when we talk about our story and we say we need to learn our history, people keep assuming that our history is about antiquity. It's about a few thousand years ago, 100 years ago. We have been under the cosh of white supremacy for the last 500 years. That's a fact. They don't even want to apologize for what they did. They want to turn around and say, well, we didn't do it. No, but you benefit. Some years ago, about 5-6 years ago, and this is a true story, because you know they do tours to Brixton now. No, seriously, the tours. Holiday tour, and some white people come from Switzerland and come on tour at Brixton, and them say, where are all the black people them there? And what we want our money back. Because Brixton is black people, African people make Brixton a world icon. Now, yes, European people, you were here first, your English and thing, but when you were here, it was dead. Even the Jews, when they came here, didn't want to stay in Brixton. They left and went Golders Green and Stamford Hill. But when the Africans from the Caribbean and the few that came from the continent came to Brixton, it was a dump. The only time that you read about Brixton in European history is when Queen Victoria went on holiday. She was going to holiday in Brixton, and she went by boat. Because Brixton is built upon a marshland. And in the 50s, and Devon can testify to this, in the 50s when our parents first came here, whenever there was heavy rain, all the houses them on Rayton Road would flood. Because the River Ephra flows from Gypsy Hill all the way down into Brixton, out to the River Thames. But when Africans came here, we nice it up. Yeah? We put a little flavor in the place. When white people was there, you couldn't smell nothing in the air but fog. When we come, you smell jerk chicken and fish and all them things and rice and peas. When you come, 10 o'clock, them gone at them bed. 10 o'clock, we just address up. They didn't want them dump houses. Look at the houses now. We can't even buy them. In fact, we can't even look at them. You walk in Brixton now and white people looking like, where ya do ya? You know, what is all these black people? Brixton Village, they call it now. I remember when we had the best in there. When we had the record shops there. And real time was Desmond Hip City. Every corner that you went in Brixton, you heard music. That's what white people did like. They didn't like coming to Brixton in the day. Nighttime, they're missing. Now you see them at nighttime, and you can see them because they're bright. Brixton light up now. There is a move to destabilize our community. See, when you are a hub, and as because people, you know, there's a few Europeans in there. I need to speak the language so they can, you know, grasp what I'm saying, actually. Brixton is now a hub for Europeans, but it used to be a hub for Africans, as Stafford said. Brixton was the capital for black people in Britain. It was the capital. Was. There was a comedian guy called Roger D. Manchurian. And he had a joke that he used to tell. And this was in the early part of the 90s. When we was doing comedy together. He used to tell a joke that one day, black people is going to disappear from Britain. And they're going to have a museum. And he's going to say, black people used to be here. Now we have the black archives. To say black people used to be in Brixton. Brixton has totally changed. Like Devon said, I'm a bit more radical. I'm younger than Devon still, so me, you know, the radical business still. Yeah? Brixton has totally had a facelift. You can't recognize it. And all these things, our family was one of the first family to suffer of that compulsory purchase order. They bought the whole of the road, and you had to say they fought for 3 years, but they took the road, and it happened just after our parents finished paying for their yard. And remember, you know, white people didn't used to buy a house. They used to rent it. It was only the wealthy used to buy properties. But ordinary working class white people didn't buy properties. African people were forced to buy properties because when they came here in the 50s and the early part of the 60s, you wouldn't rent nowhere to them. All down Ladbroke Grove and all them places. Them places was, they used to call them ghettos. Go and do your archive research in the newspapers. They used to call all those places Dalston, Tottenham, Harlesden, Clapton, Brixton, Lewisham, Balham, Peckham, Camberwell, Kennington, Stockwell, everywhere around here. They were called what? Say after me. Ghettos. Look at them now. Look at them now. So you will hear people say, poor white people has been pushed out through gentrification. I don't use the word gentrification no more. It's not gentrification. It's whitification. It's simple. But we played a part in that. We played a part in that. Because the decent black people, them, look, everywhere you go, there's crime. Crime is everywhere. Even in Brixton today, there's crime going on. There's crime going on everywhere. If there was no crime, you wouldn't need the police. Crime is everywhere. So it doesn't matter how affluent an area is. Look at Dunblane. Man just go get mad one day and just go around and shoot down, kill off all the people them. Just in the United States there's been another shooting. Was it Oregon? 13, 17 people. Why people just get mad when they get a gun? Them just kill everybody. And say, shit, this is good. Let me kill myself too. Masochists. So what I'm saying is, 30 years on, no justice. If we haven't got no justice in 500 years, 30 years ain't nothing. They show you their temperament of how they deal with us. And this is not an attack. This is not an attack on the ordinary people. This is an attack on the state. The state has no respect. They do what they do because they can. That's why they do it. Because they can. But when one little something happen to one of them people, them know, them draw the drawbridge down and all kind of something, and all kind of media mogul come out. Till this day, Cherry has not had justice. Because if the woman children don't have justice, how can she have justice? I'm going to leave it on this line because Lee's going to come and close. The native, oh, Lee's going to close, but we got something else before that. Yeah? The Native American says, the white man speaks with forked tongue. How many juki pop on a fark? Tell you one thing. Them tell you, say, the Native American sign over land. Them couldn't read English. Them speaking of Sioux and Hiawatha and all them something. They hate, hey, why you got the war? And you come with your English to tie up people and then say it's legal. So history is not 500 years ago. Even today, we are making history. You understand? So, when I look at political part, women just giving, you know, and people just get tired and, oh, go. I mean, some people come with them white bridge in them and feel, oh, quick, man, shut up, man. White people, that's cool, man. We're nice. I'll talk to you after and have a laugh. Nothing personal. And that's how, and that's what we picked up when we was here. We learned to be bilingual. The children now are not bilingual. We had about 4 different ways we spoke. We had the way that you spoke to your parents. We had the way you spoke to your teachers. We had the way you spoke when you answered the phone. And we had the way you spoke when you was with your brethren. And then you had the way you spoke when you was with your white brethren. Because when you was with white brethren, you give it all of that. Like, you know what I mean? What's that? Yeah, 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 yeah. And you'll have your black bridge in there and your white bridge. Hey, Tom, what's going on, man? What are you doing? You're going on football. Yeah, Patrick, yeah, you're going to rave later. And then you see an elder come and say, what you do there? Boy, I'm all right, you know, ma'am. Good evening, Mrs. Williams. How are you? We were bilingual. So we learned. We were adaptable. We were able to adapt. So we adapt. We integrated. But we didn't assimilate difference. Anyway, with all of that stuff now, I'm going to bring a little joy in the place now. We've got a Brixton person, still in Brixton, living in Brixton. I want you to give it up for our poet, who's the young vanguard to Linton Kwesi Johnson, and live on the same road as him, funny enough. Give it up for Laura Lee!
Give thanks. Wow, Kwaku boy, and the power that comes out of him. I want to share with you a poetry piece, but just quickly to just say that, you know, what happened 30 years ago when I was actually born, when unfortunate things happened with Cherry Groce and the family, those things still happen now because police have knocked on my door on Railton Road and have pushed themselves into my house and have chopped me on the floor and have kicked me down and have sprayed me with CS gas. 2 big grown 6'2" men said that they couldn't control me. Yeah, I know I'm strong and big, but still, you know, and these people, they take the pee up till now. And I had to go to the court and I had to fight them, and the magistrate's court found me guilty. And I'm a youth worker, so that can't happen. Do you know what I'm saying? My record cannot have something on it saying that I assaulted a policeman. So I fought them against my lawyer's consent. And I went to the Crown Court and I was found not guilty because they could not. They are stupid enough. These two grown police officers are stupid enough to not be able to get their story straight. Yeah? So when they're up in the court, sooner or later, the truth will come out. And the truth came out that they had pushed into my house without no right to do that. And so, you know, things are still happening. So the piece that I'm going to share with you is called Revolutionary Army. I wrote this a few years ago, so I'm just going to give you a section of it because it's quite long. But I'm going to give you a piece of it. And it's just to say that actually we need a revolutionary army. And that's why we're gathering here to learn our history and to learn what we can now do for the present in order to make a better future for the younger ones. So tune in. Do I need this? Yes. Poets don't like mics. All right. I'm looking for an army, yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm calling all recruits. This ain't no OY story. No, no, no. 'Cause the revolution's due. I'm looking for an army, yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm calling all recruits. This ain't no OY story. No, 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 no. 'Cause the revolution's due. Tune into my frequency as I spit the reality, combating their virtual insanity. Creating their fantasy world for escapism, but see, there is no escaping these isms. It's not an illusion, divine revelation, for in order for there to be revolution, we must declare war against their injustices. Trust, this is about harmony, love, peace and unity, but ultimately it's about claiming back what's rightfully ours. See, their capitalist society trying to keep us boxed. Materialist media trying to keep us locked into 50-inch plasma box television, deterring you from your mission, telling me soaps to pick real life. When Managa Teeth, their best friend's wife, all their shine me is pure strife. Injecting impressionable minds with poison. So now our youths think it's acceptable to break God's natural laws. Pure disrespect, but they think it's normal. Then people want to complain when they start acting rational. Funny how if you've got the right amount of money, you can do what you want. Watch carefully as they put on their front, claiming this is a land without dictation. Well, can I please have an explanation for why free speech is now confined to Hyde Park Corner? Order, order, order in the courts, laying hands on God's word, telling me in God they trust. Truth is they've been snorting fairy dust. See, my third eye sees a spirit of lust. Money hungry, corporately greedy, ignorantly needy, living off Mama Africa's resources. I refuse to sit back and ignore this. See, God said to go forth and preach the gospel. Christ's blood fell to defeat all evil. Well, I fear that some have misunderstood. See, missionaries picked up your word and used your name in vain, but on judgment day they will be slain in remembrance of the billions who felt the pain of shackles, strained life, men who've had to comfort their raped wives, those who live in slums from Brazil to Soweto, Chad to the Congo, throughout the world in all the ghettos, blood-stained streets speak of inhumane humanity, whilst the US sits back and watches in glee as the World Bank gets fatter and taxes get higher and the music industry gets whacker and whacker as they pump money into bling bling and booty shaking. Suddenly pimping is calling. If you're not in it, you're a fool. Better teach your children the ground rules before they go to school, because once they're in the mainstream, it's all over. From Cardiff to the streets of Dover, guns be pop, pop, popping. Suddenly it's an epidemic. But when it's confined to the streets of Brixton, they didn't give a funny, isn't it? Not. See, they want to arrest me for bunning sensey, but when Pete Doherty talking smack, it's a fallacy of double standards. Babylon planned this. See, I see another brother on street cracked out, telling me some story about his electricity's run out, like I'm going to fall for that one. See, I'm sweating when I think about my godson and daughter, when I take a look around at the manic slaughter. Got us killing each other for street status, claiming NW this and SE that. Don't you know, boy, you're a rat in a trap. Silly picnies, don't be their guinea pigs. Take a look around, we don't own any of this. Ignorant fools playing with tools, it's a vicious cycle. See, an elder once told me, don't put too much politics in your first CD. I laughed politely and replied, why? They wouldn't want to sign me anyway, because my sound is too black, my ass is too fat, my voice is too jazzy, my lyrics are too full of reality. Plus, politics is life, and my music is meant to make you think twice, ease the strife, whilst sharing some of what I've learned. You see, the most powerful medium is under the devil's control. So when my tongue was blessed, I knew I had to let go, just let it flow. I promised God I wouldn't misuse this gift, but do it justice. So now my question to you is this: are you part of the problem or part of the solution? So as we raise our hands in unity, raise your hands with me. You're signing up now to be part of the revolutionary army. I'm looking for an army, yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm calling now recruits. This ain't no OI story, yeah, yeah, yeah. See the revolution's jewel. I'm looking for an army. Each and every one of you signing up your name. I'm looking for an army, yeah. 'Cause the revolution's due. 2015 is still due. Be part of the army. Bless. Woo!
I know there's some children in here, and I'm just going to turn over to my cousin Lee in 2 seconds. Tell your children your story. Don't hide nothing from them, so that it never happens again. So that when they go into these institutions of brainwashing, that they take what they need from it and don't waste their time. Sit down with your children in the evenings when they come from school and just ask them simple questions. How was school today? What did you learn? Don't take it that they're going to educate your children. They're not educating your children. They are training them. You are the one that needs to educate them. Remember, the word education comes from the word educare, which means to draw out that which is in. You have to do that. It's been a beautiful first half. I've enjoyed it. I'm honored that you listened attentively to the panel and myself. In the words of our ancient ancestors, the ancient Kemetians, Itepe Neke, J.R. Senebe, divine peace, long life, stability, and good health, I'm going to turn you over to my cousin, Leave Lawrence. Hail him up, please.
Good evening, everybody. Firstly, I want to thank you all for coming out this evening. This means a lot to me and my family that you're here today to acknowledge the 30th commemoration of when my mum was shot back in 1985 by the police. Wrongfully shot, I should say, yeah? Thank you very much for turning out. So I know we're running a bit over time, so I'm not going to speak too much. I'm going to show a little video in a minute, but before we do so, is Tasita here? All right, Tasita. Where's, come here, Eden. Yeah? And Harmony, come here. Right, so my little nephew and my daughter. Now, the reason why I'm bringing them out here right now is because, how old are you, Eden?
11.
All right, so I was 11 years old when the police burst into my mother's house and shot her in front of me. So I want you to understand that, because when you see me as an adult, yeah, as a 31-year-old man, it's hard to connect to what really happened, yeah, and the impact that that had. How old are you, Harmony?
7.
Okay, so my sister Lisa was 8 years old, just 1 year older than Harmony when this incident happened, and she was in the house at the time also, right? So I just want to get you focused, right, on what really happened, right, and the ages that we were at the time of this incident, right? Well done. Well done, bro.